Hachette Audio presents A Better Man, written by Leah McLaren, read by Eva Kaminsky. For Rob. How can I know who I am until I see what I do? How can I know what I value until I see where I walk? Carl Weick. Chapter 1. Nick Wakefield is a happily married man. That is the official story. But even in this moment, a mild, unremarkable midweek dawn in late September, a school day, as Maya would call it, he is clinging to the enviable outward qualities of his life, as if to bits of driftwood in a flash flood. It is, by any standard, a good life. A life of privilege and endless opportunities for pleasure. And yet, it is also a life that has made him miserable. Slumped over the cool stone kitchen island in a pilled cashmere bathrobe, the perfect Christmas gift for the dad who has everything, Nick performs the early morning accounting he's been laboring at each day upon waking for a couple of years now. A keeping up of appearances in his own head. Not a show of gratitude, exactly, but a listing off of the things that if he could connect himself to the glittering hologram of his own success, he might well be grateful for. These are the things he is sure other people would like to take from him, if they ever got the chance. Topping the slate is this house, the one he's sitting in now, a bomb-proof Edwardian boulder on a city street that his slick, post-adolescent real estate agent once described as the fillet of the neighborhood, a description Nick secretly relishes, but would never have the bad taste to repeat out loud. Then there's the lake house, a cube of glass and steel perched on a slab of pink granite 2.5 hours north of the city. The view was chosen for its resemblance to a Group of Seven painting. Rocks rising out of choppy waters, a couple of craggy, wind-battered pines emerging miraculously from cracks in the stone. He thinks of the place now, and is filled not with pleasure, but with the intense desire to buy the uninhabited island opposite. Always own your view. His late father, a workaholic, alcoholic dental surgeon, liked to say. It's the single piece of wisdom he retained from the man, and he cleaves to it. In and around these shelters, these properties that he owns, and that no one, not even the bank, since the Duracell job came through, has the power to take away from him, there is all manner of precious things. There are the cars, the boats, the collection of Danish teak mid-century modern furniture, the books and gadgets and photographs, and a few pieces by local sculptors he long since stopped pretending to understand or care about. There are his bikes, all six of them. Two super lightweight carbon-framed French road racers in contrasting primary colors. A puffy-wheeled, shock-fitted mountain bike for a month-long race across Mongolia that he had to cancel at the last minute. A half-constructed, custom-built fixed gear. And two standard-issue commuter bikes from his teens he hangs on to, with the idea that he might one day revert to being the sort of modest fellow who cycles to work, instead of sliding a luxury sedan into a private parking spot 2 feet from his office door. There is more. The collection of copper cooking pots hanging above his head. The specially commissioned modernist stone birdbath twisting into view like a lost Henry Moore. The empty coffee cup in his hand, white bone china and soothingly logo-free. Although he works in advertising, perhaps because of it, he has imposed a strict no-swag or overtly branded items rule in the house. A collection of objects, all of them expensive, solid, and most important, desirable, parade past his mind's eye. As they do, he feels the old anxiety, that familiar hunted gut clench that wakes him before light most mornings now. Eyes springing open, stomach lifting as whoosh, the elevator drops, rising up before it recedes to the background, where it will stay all day like a threat. Nick pours himself another cup of ethical sludge from the French press and glances at the oven clock. 7 a.m. on the dot. Right on cue, the pre-programmed kitchen radio warbles to life, a smug-voiced host analyzing the international misery of the day. The voices is how he thinks of them, having never understood his wife's obsession with public radio, some nerdy hangover of her academic childhood. The voices are followed almost immediately by the sound of Maya's bare feet, moving across the bedroom floor to the master bathroom for her morning ablutions. She will dress in something stretchy and body contoured, selected from her vast collection of expensive sweat-wicking exercise togs, before giving the twins their breakfast and supplemental breastfeed for the natural antibodies, dropping them at preschool and hitting the gym. Nick will go to work and stay there as long as possible, as he has taken to doing for the past several months, ever since Maya settled the twins into a comfortable bedtime routine. It's not that he is avoiding his family exactly, just that his presence seems to disrupt some precarious balance it's taken his wife sleepless months to perfect. Maya did her best not to let on, but he could sense her bristling at his occasional, now infrequent to non-existent, attempts at new man domesticity. An awkwardly loaded dishwasher here, a scalding bath there, and now he has given up. There was a time when they had dinner together most nights, gently unwinding the day's events over a bowl of pasta and a glass of wine. But this ritual has long since passed, surrendered to the necessary, no, enviable chaos of buttered macaroni, bath toys, and slobbered-on picture books. A chaos he copes with by keeping himself as scarce as possible.
Daddy?
A small sticky hand tugs at his robe, causing it to fall open and exposing his genitals to a gust of cold air. Sweetheart, it's rude to yank. He says this with more impatience than he'd intended. Isla pops a thumb in her rosebud mouth, and with her finger, loops a swirl of red-gold hair around her ear. Her eyes, a clear, glittering blue, unlike his own murky hazel ones, crawl across his face. What are they looking for? Nick reaches down and scoops his daughter onto his lap. But his vague hope that she might zone out quietly while he finishes reading the basketball box scores evaporates, as Isla, snuffling with her first cold of the season, squirms around to look at him. It's not that she wants down. It's that she wants his full attention.
Daddy?
Yes, sweetheart?
Foster sleeps with garbage truck, and I sleep with mermaid.
Is that so?
Yep.
She nods, mouth twisting. A square crust of snot has formed beneath her upturned nose, like a fluorescent yellow Hitler mustache.
Garbage truck is blue, and mermaid's pink, with green scales for swimming and long hair. Foster's a boy like you, Daddy, and I'm a girl, like mermaid and mommy.
Nick nods and strokes the whole of his daughter's head, a clumsy palm sweeping over a fragile corn silk dome. Isla grins, suddenly pleased with herself. Then she sneezes, not once, but twice, three times, spraying him with microbial bacteria. Nick winces and resists pushing her off his lap.
Girls are nice and boys are yucky, except for Foster, because he's my twin, she says.
No, sweetheart, Nick begins. But Isla's on a roll.
Yes, Daddy, boys are yucky.
Why is that?
They like killing games and explosions, and they don't know how to love people.
Nick struggles not to react. Where'd you hear that, baby?
Foster tries to make me play with his stupid killing soldiers, but I hate them.
Not that bit, darling. The second part. Isla shrugs, pops her thumb back in her mouth, hops off her father's lap, and eyes him with something more innocent than suspicion and less affectionate than warmth. Nick wants to press further, but Foster is suddenly upon them, an agent of pure destruction. Is there no object? Nick can't help wondering. His son doesn't yearn to pick up and hurl to the ground. No system of organization he doesn't long to smash. Cupboards fly open. Pots are banged with wooden spoons. A brand new salad spinner spontaneously combusts, bits of plastic flying in every direction.
Daddy, Daddy, check it!
Foster's voice rings through the din. He's a tall
boy. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.